Hi everybody, it's Lynn from wisconsingarden.com and today we're taking you on a mid-July garden tour so that you can see what is blooming at this time of year for this year. And behind me, if you've never seen giant fleece plant, you know why they call it giant.
Would you put your arms straight up in the air, because the actual top from the perspective is at least 2 foot taller than you. So, you know, you're looking at a plant that is at least, I guesstimate, 9 foot tall right now, and I don't know if it's done growing, but it is starting to get heavy.
Right, and this is the flower, obviously. It has the smell, like we've always said, of leather. So if you like the smell of leather, this is it. Sometimes the Japanese beetles will be on here, but they haven't arrived in force yet, so
if you would just lift these leaves down, I want people to see what's actually growing inside. To me, it reminds me of a bamboo forest.
Right. It is not bamboo, so you don't need to worry about that. It does get, the base does get bigger, but it doesn't spread all over everywhere and take over. And once it stops blooming or the blooms get ugly looking, I will chop this probably in about half. And then some of them will rebloom, but not quite as magnificent as this. Now, also, these are our hardy hibiscus. And I believe, are these the ones that...
They're all white.
...that Logan and... Luke.
Yes, these are newly transplanted this spring.
Right, so this spring our grandson Logan and his friend Luke had moved these, and they are doing magnificently. You did a good job, guys.
And these too will grow about 10 foot tall. How big are their blossoms?
They're dinner plate size, like this. And there'll be a new bloom every day with many more coming along, and they'll go almost all the way till fall, to the frost.
And how about this?
This is fine leaf buckthorn. So you hear bad things about buckthorn, but as we've said in the past, this is fine line buckthorn. It doesn't spread any seeds. It's sterile. And it stays in this cone or pyramidal, shape. Down below you see the spirea is almost done. The columbine is done. So what I usually just do is tip it over and let the seeds fall back down where they started. This is rose mallow. So if you know what a hibiscus is, same family, rose mallow is the...
These are the miniatures.
this is the family that started all the hibiscus. Behind that is a herbaceous peony, the kind of peony you grew up with your grandparents. These need to be cut off now so that all the energy is going into the root rather than making seeds. We also planted cannas, and we didn't know if they'd show up or not.
I think you have planted a tomato.
Oh, there is a tomato. What is that doing here? That's in there with that...
grass.
That Japanese
fern leaf peony
yeah, that we transplanted, and for some reason a tomato came with it. Oh well.
Well, we'll let that tomato go.
This is ragweed. This is not good if you're allergic to ragweed like I am, so that has to come out as well. And
well, at least most of the peonies that we planted in this area are coming back.
Coming up, rather. Right, they were newly planted, so we planted 8 of them. 5 of them have come up.
Actually, we planted 16.
Well, though, some of them are over.
I know.
But the cannas are the ones we kept over winter. We've shared them. We planted them in probably April, late April. Weren't sure they were going to come up because it took forever. But once the weather turned warm and it started raining, up they came.
But you said you dug one up and found that the roots are growing.
That was the peonies.
Or peonies.
Right, those were peony leaves, yeah. That peony roots that in another area we planted some of the same varieties of peonies, and so far we haven't seen them. So I dug one up just to look at the roots, and it seemed to be fine. Honeysuckle is in its glory at this point. Hummingbirds, butterflies, bees, they love it. Mm. And then there's the...
We call them ditch lilies.
Some people call them ditch lilies. Some people call them tiger lilies. We know they're not tiger lilies because they don't have spots on them. But...
Oh, look at my favorite.
There is the bindweed.
Yeah.
The bindweed that binds everything.
And the morning glory family.
Right, it's in the morning glory family. It looks cute. Not going to go to seed in my garden.
Just pull out a vine once. Just.
Well, I don't want to ruin this bed. So let me go over here and show you what it looks like.
It will strangle everything.
Yes, it'll just take over. It's trying to take over the fleece plant. So what happens is, you come out here, and this is what you have to do, because all of this is bindweed.
I think half our trailer is full of bindweed already.
I believe it is.
And then there's another pile back there.
It just goes around and around and around itself.
It loves to strangle and hold on to other plants and dominate them.
And this is our new hydrangea.
Hydrangea.
This is a tree hydrangea. It's being strangled by bindweed.
Now look at that. It's in the tree. We just planted this tree, 3 months ago?
Uh-huh.
That's scary.
Well, I'll have to come out and do it more carefully, because this one just started blooming this past week. But look. There it is. And it comes up. I don't even know what's under there because it's just covered at this point.
Oh, the nemesis. So when you talk about morning glories, this is why I shudder every single time somebody, you should grow morning glories in your garden.
Who would say such a thing?
I wouldn't mention any names.
Another fleece plant. More lilies. Then we've got, this is our quince. This is the one that has the spines on it. But look, what's growing in it.
I have to be very careful.
Yeah.
And look at this. I mean, it's just covering the ground. We've been spending so much time working in the vegetable garden.
With thistles.
And thistles. We've not even been out here in the front.
No, we haven't. And then... these poor ferns have not yet decided that their shade trees are gone. This is one of our crab apple trees, which is kind of struggling to me.
Yeah.
I don't know. We're keeping our eye on that one. We do have a guarantee that it will grow.
But look at your bindweed growing on the top of this one.
I know. This is our other crab apple that I will have to get a ladder to get up there to pull it down.
Yeah, well, then you have grapes that are trying to grow in here.
Yes, we do.
Which have been here forever.
Yes, since we've been here.
They're just
before.
Solid in there, but look what's developing.
The Montauk daisies are here.
This was one of those little baby Montauk daisies that we put out here.
Yep.
And
then
already,
this horrible stuff.
Oh, don't ever put this in your garden.
This is a chameleon plant. Smells awful when you...
smells like metal.
Yep. Goes to seed. It gets everywhere. And there's the flower.
Yep.
And when I first saw it, I thought, oh, that's very attractive. Because look at all the different colors on the leaves. Well, little did I know.
A wool and sheep, whatever that is.
This is sweet pea. That I don't know where it came from, but it does like to grow here, and it does look pretty. It's got pretty colors. More Montauk daisies. Some of our grasses are coming up. Now, that stuff that's purple, it's got purple flowers. That is, let me think, deadly nightshade. It's in the potato family. It's used to kill people sometimes. It's awful.
Is that why you're growing it, Lynn?
No.
Do I need to know about this?
It's growing by itself.
And oh, okay.
Last year when I was working in this area later in the summer, I found out that this was one of the places that it likes to grow. So I'm going to have to come in here when the bees aren't around and pull this out as well. Whew. Lots to do.
And is that... We had another one of these plants at the
entrance, a trumpet vine.
I mean, look at that. It's trying to reach out and strangle our other new tree, our eastern redbud.
See, when you buy things, you really have to believe what they say about them as far as taking over, because like Creeping Buttercup, we should know better. This is one of our Macintosh apples, and this year it's outdoing itself. Last year, I think maybe had just a couple apples on it, maybe three or four. And this year, it's loaded with apples. And we think it's because in the spring, we did quite a bit of vigorous trimming. But also because the maple trees that we had to cut down are now gone and their shade is gone, the apple trees have a better chance of growing.
They're thriving here.
They are.
Now, why did we plant them here?
Well, you planted them here so that kids on their way to high school, if they got hungry or on their way home, could pick an apple and eat it. Perhaps last week you saw when I was moving these plants. These are bugbane. They get to be about this tall, and they have a unique flowering and seed system. But I was also transplanting sunflowers that the birds planted when they didn't eat all of their bird seed. So they were over there near the bird feeder, and I thought, well, I'm just going to move them over here. And I know in the past when I've done this, they will look terrible for about 3 days, but you have to keep watering them. And these should probably have some stakes on them.
Yep.
And once they take root and decide this is where they're going to be, they start blooming. So even though they were wilted and awful looking, there they are.
Who knew?
Who knew? If you're thinking about adding native plants to your landscape, here is one that is truly unique. This is a compass plant. And it's called compass because when the pioneers were crossing the grasslands and the prairies way back when, this was a plant they could easily find, and it directed them as to which way was north and south, because the majority of the leaves will align themselves north and south. Now these may be affected by the shade of some of the trees around them, but they are also very sandpapery. So even in the dark, you can tell that this is what kind of plant it is. Now these look prickly, but they're not. But it probably kept deer and other animals from eating it, cows or whatever. When it came up in the spring, there was nothing here. You couldn't even see that there was a plant here, except for the marker. But in just the last 2 weeks, I would say, it has gone way past my head.
Well, some of these plants, you can literally put a chair out, like the giant fleece plant, and sit there and watch it grow.
Now, you would think for a plant that's so very large, the flowers would be much more spectacular, more like a sunflower seed. But
can you tip one without breaking it?
That's about it.
Okay. It's kind of a sunflower shape.
Yeah. And another prairie plant that you might consider, again, very interesting, is prairie dock. These huge leaves are amazing. And what we learned when we were on the prairie tour is no matter how hot it is outside, if you put your hand on either side of one of these leaves, it's always cool, especially the top side.
Well, the pioneers used to put it on top of their head to keep them cooler, the sun off.
The reason being is that native plants, the roots go down 14 feet, so they are constantly bringing up the coolness of the earth. This one is going to be blooming again.
This gets very tall, though.
The bloom is not spectacular. It's kind of like the compass plant, and it'll be yellow, just like the compass.
Now, we did have one next to our kitchen window, and what did we do with that one?
Well, it was too big for where it was, and it was in the shade, so we moved it, and it got very happy. We also gave a piece to a neighbor, and I mean, it does. Once you have it planted someplace, it's really hard to move all of it because they keep coming back. These also are native plants. This is Virginia Culver's root. This will have a fine little purpley white flower to it. Just very attractive, very unassuming. These are prairie coneflowers. And these will have, this is the head of it, and the leaves on it will droop backwards, or the petals on the head will droop backwards. That's how you know it's a native plant, rather than the coneflowers that we buy in the store, and you see all the leaves around it. Earlier in the season, we showed you a picture of the driveway when all these daisies were in bloom, and they were fantastic. They were just really lovely, and if you like daisies, you were walking up the driveway with a smile on your face. But I knew that if we waited too long, they were all going to go to seed. So with daisies, what you have to do is cut them way back. And you can see when you're looking at a plant,
that one you're holding is already going to re-blossom.
Yes, it is. So even though we cut, well, you can see all these that we cut back. And these were at least up to here, drooping over the side, over the driveway. Cut them back, they will bloom again.
Not as spectacular, but they will
True.
Bloom.
Yes.
And so, I mean, considering the entire driveway,
yep,
both sides of the driveway,
yep,
were just full of daisies.
Yes.
And look, we still haven't moved all of the mulch from our maple trees.
No, we haven't. Nope. It just may wait until fall.
I think so.
Who knows?
Maybe next spring at the rate we're going here,
and
with Canadian thistles.
These are tickweed flowers, they're called.
I love these.
Yeah, well, they will be everywhere.
Good. I'd rather have these than bindweed.
True. Very true.
And then, look,
happen.
You have some more escapees. How come you didn't transplant these?
I don't know. There's just too many. They're everywhere. They're everywhere. Another fleece plant as well. This one I keep chopping at because it gets in my way for the pathway. I have to have a way to get through here. So this has been chopped. So if you want to see what the inside looks like, you can take a gander in there. And you can see that all of those stems are green, which shows you that's how much it grew just this year. Those are all new stems that came up from the beginning of spring.
I mean, there was nothing there. It was down to the ground.
But the problem is, underneath here are some of my very prettiest
variegated flux.
Flux, thank you. And if I don't keep trimming these back, they get hidden.
Plus also your some more.
More honeysuckle.
Yeah.
Yep. And these ferns have actually realized that their shade is gone.
Yeah.
And they will just continue to turn brown and, oh well, can't keep everybody happy.
Well, look at how some of your dahlias are doing.
Dahlias are starting to blossom. This is one of them. There's some corn from the birds.
Oh, good. Sweet corn, I hope.
And this is the bugbane that I moved. So when I said it has an unusual flower and
that's
seed
quite a
possibility.
Flower, yeah.
Yes, it's called pearl flower because those look like little pearls. And then when they open, they're They're like if you look right here, you can see. That's why they call it pearl. Hmm. And each one of those is a flower, and each one will have a seed.
And look what else is starting to bloom or blossom.
There's more dahlias. And this is butterfly weed. So this is the orange butterfly weed that the monarchs love. More dahlias. This is a husker red.
Red husker?
Which is a perennial. So it's already bloomed.
Did you chop those?
I've chopped those off because I don't want seeds everywhere. This year I planted Mexican sunflower seeds, and this is one of my babies. This is how it looks, minus a couple of petals, but this could get at least a couple feet taller, and it's not a perennial, it's an annual, but it's spectacular when it does bloom.
But the one I really like.
The one you like is the helenium. This is autumn red gold helenium. And this one, if the season is long enough, depending on when it comes up, this one is loaded with yellow flowers. It's like somebody had a bouquet of yellow flowers and just planted it right there.
There will be hundreds and hundreds of blossoms and the pollinators. I mean, you can just sit here and almost identify every different pollinator possible.
They love them, yes. And it comes at a time when pollinators are needed. Now, looking in where I used to have all my zinnias, these are dahlias. Different varieties of dahlias that are about to bloom. I had to kind of be careful because of our new lighting, pretty lighting system that shows up in the evening. So I had to keep them away from the edges. But we did have some problems with some insect that was chewing on them when they were babies. And so I've been moving other dahlias around and putting in with the ones that were already established. But they'll come along. They're pretty.
And I gave your little weeping tree a haircut.
Oh yes, we did that in the spring. We trimmed it a little and then Rick trimmed it again just to try to keep it in an umbrella shape. And I'm really liking what's happening. Now over here are our tree peonies. This is what they look like in the summertime once they're done blooming.
Are you going to let these go to seed?
Nope, I'm cutting those heads off.
Okay, because you had spectacular yellow.
Yeah, that tall one there is the... The one.
Ito.
Yep.
Again, that's a mix between a tree peony and a herbaceous peony.
Correct. Now, this is a native coneflower, and you can see that the blossoms are all down. These are very neat. They are very stiff.
And the birds and the bees and love
the ants.
Them. Yep.
But that's a perennial. That comes back every year.
Oh, look what else you have growing here.
These are...
My.
This is our bird food garden.
Yep. And you forgot we planted garlic in here.
I forgot I put garlic in here. I had a bunch of leftover garlic last year, and I put it in, and I totally forgot. I'm like, what is all of this? It's in such a nice row grid. But if you look closely inside there, you can see those huge leaves of the prairie dock that we have now dug out at least twice.
I think the roots are so deep, I don't know if we'll ever get rid of it.
Probably not.
Now, do you think the garlic's going to keep the raccoons and the deer away from here?
No.
I haven't seen deer here lately.
Yeah, but the plants were growing since spring.
True.
I will be cutting those scapes off because I do not want more garlic right there. But our Japanese maple tree has really turned into a spectacular
bush.
And I've trimmed it a couple of times just to get rid of the ones that are sticking out more. But it's the color is so pretty with the
nice
coral bells.
Yep.
And then we did plant some caladium bulbs, which took forever to come up, but they came up.
And even
finally,
your elephant
ears are coming.
Yeah.
but you see there's thistles. Now those are not Canadian thistles. Those are just the old thistles we always had.
Yeah, we've got a lot of weeding to do in here.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Well, if you enjoyed this mid-July part one of our garden tour, thank you so much for watching. We'd love a thumbs up if you are up to that. And we'd like to encourage you to watch part two as it comes up. Thank you for watching. Thank you for subscribing. If you already have, if you haven't, there is a little subscribe button here. And there's a little bell above it for an announcement when we do a new video. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.